Steve Dotto here. How the heck are you doing? Me? I'm doing pretty good, thanks. We just got off of producing a live webinar last week that I thought I would share with you the tale of how we ended up putting it together. That's going to be our topic today on growing your YouTube channel to 100,000 subscribers, doing a live event and hosting a live event. Now, if you've been following our channel for a while, you know that I've been dabbling a little bit more with doing live events and primarily using Google Hangouts at this point, although I've done live events previously using some other technologies. I've converted my radio show from where it was before now into a weekly Google Hangout, and it's coming along pretty well. But this was a webinar that I wanted to promote, I wanted to create a large audience for, and we wanted to teach something within it. Now, typically speaking, a lot of people would produce these webinars as part of an internet marketing campaign with a sale of a course or a book or something out the back end of it. That wasn't the case in this particular one, although we certainly could have used it that way. We certainly could have had a call to action and a sale within it. But this webinar that we produced was Going Paperless with Evernote, and I was just working with my partner, Brooks Duncan, a colleague of mine here in Vancouver who was my partner on this particular project. Brooks is a super knowledgeable guy about all things paperless. He knows his scanners inside and out, and he's become a real expert on Evernote as well. And it was one of the most requested features one of the most requested webinars when I put out questionnaires to our audience. They want to learn more about Evernote. They want to learn more about the paperless office, and the two fit really nicely together. So Brooks and I got together and we said, let's put on a webinar and let's see how it works. And let's try a unique technique. Let's try doing something a little bit different with this one. And let's produce it to create a hybrid webinar where we introduce ourselves live, then we go to a pre-recorded webinar and then come back live, answer questions, and let's see if we can be successful with it. So the process that we went on was, first of all, Brooks had about 2 weeks to prepare the content. I didn't have too much prep work to do at that particular point. I prepared some graphics to promote it. We did a pretty good job of promoting this webinar. A lot of you might have taken the webinar in. We actually had, let me go over to Webinar Jam and show you the kind of the statistics on it. So this is Webinar Jam. This is what we finally delivered the webinar in. And this is it right here. It's called Paperless Evernote 1. And so we delivered... Brooks and I determined that we were going to give people multiple times that they could take it in. It also allowed us to kind of learn how to do things as we went along. As is often the case with these, or I imagine almost always the case, the very first one had a much higher number of people in it than all of the others. But this is, let me go back. Webinar Jam is where we created the invitations and where I finally delivered the webinar. Webinar Jam is a shell that sits on top of Google Hangouts. Now, it is got some great benefits going for it, but it's also fraught with some challenges because we're using multiple people's technology. We're using the Webinar Jam people's technology for enrolling people, and it's got a nice feature that allows people to take in a Google Hangout that don't have a Google Plus account. So it opens the doors to a lot more people, but it also creates an extra layer of technology on top of Google Hangouts where things can break. And we did have issues as we went along. It wasn't absolutely clean sailing, but I'll tell you about those issues as we move along. But it's got a really nice interface for enrolling people. And at any point, if I just click on the view button here, it would tell me exactly how many people we have registered and give me a fair bit of analytics. So let me just walk you through the analytics of the webinar itself. Now, bear in mind, we didn't spend any money promoting this. We didn't pay money for a Facebook page post. All of the people came organically through one of our newsletter lists or through the organic sharing on Facebook or Twitter. I posted it on the YouTube channel as well. We got about 3,000 views of the video, a little promo video. So we used our social media channels in order to generate traffic, and we invited our friends to share it, but there was no money to be made, so there was no affiliate traction or anything like that happening. But still, we had 2,691 people visit the landing page to register for the webinar. Not bad. Pretty good numbers, I think. We had 1,450 people register. I kind of set a goal as we started of about 1,000, so we blew that out of the water. Brooks was thrilled. He was actually a little bit anxious as we were moving ahead. 1,400 people, holy cow. But I knew that a 50% show-up rate for a webinar is a really good show-up rate. A lot of the internet marketing community feels 30% is average. But if you take a look, you can see we hit almost spot on 50%. 53% of the people registering for it showed up, which was awesome. It was very empowering to Brooks and I and very encouraging to Brooks and I to have that many people show up. Now, as is often the case with this, the very first time we delivered it was when we discovered a lot of the little bumps in the road and kind of figured things out as we went along. Now, I've done a few hybrid webinars with Webinar Jam before, but I'm still tweaking the system, trying to learn exactly what's happening because there's some idiosyncrasies in it that that can cause some challenges. And the biggest thing that I learned with this particular time that we delivered it is that all of our clients are not equal when coming into Google Hangouts and Webinar Jam, specifically iPad and iOS clients. They weren't able to view the pre-recorded segments at all. If we were just doing it as a Google Hangout and I was just doing it live and we were working with a live format, it would have been absolutely fine. The way I do my weekly radio show now, or my weekly show with no pre-recorded content, just doing it all live, works pretty well. It's pretty much ready for prime time at that level. But when we start inserting the video stream, there's just too many variables. And of course, the video is probably coming through in Flash. I'm sure it's coming through in Flash, which of course Apple says, we don't play with Flash. So consequently, people on the iPhones were having issues. Now, Brooks and I divided the labor quite interestingly when we actually delivered the webinar. Brooks, we with the hybrid webinar, just to refresh your memory, if you don't know or if it's new to you, if you haven't heard, with a hybrid webinar, we try and go live at the beginning, and then we prepackage the video. The reason I love to prepackage the video and to pre-record the video is A, we're able to do it in a defined period of time. We've all been to webinars that have gone long or, you know, that sort of stuff. So we can define exactly how much time and make sure it's super, what we call information dense, that we're delivering a lot of value for the amount of time that we're asking our attendees to visit. The second thing we get out of it is if there's any problem, the quality actually is much higher because we've pre-recorded the video, we've pre-encoded it, we've uploaded it to the web, so we don't have the upload process as a part of the delivery process. It's just downloading to you. All we do is we start the video playing and then it's downloading from an Amazon server or a YouTube server to you. So the quality of video coming through and the quality of audio is much higher. And the third thing is, although this is a little bit of a misnomer, is if there's technical issues, we've all been going through webinars where the poor host has had a technical issue and they get all verklempt and they lose all the energy and it's like the air going out of a balloon. That doesn't happen because it's all pre-recorded and theoretically it's going to go smoothly. Now, we did have issues, but the presenters never lost any energy because we pre-recorded it and we didn't know there were issues at that particular time. Now, that's not saying that at the other end, people who were viewing the webinar didn't have the air go out of their balloon, but I didn't notice that as much. So the division of labor that happened during the webinar. And the other thing is that the other thing about these hybrid webinars that I think is very cool, although not without issues, it turns out, is we are able to engage with the audience in chat while the video is running. So we could sidebar with them and answer questions. Now, to be fair, a lot of our audience, a reasonable percentage, felt that that was distracting. That the sidebar chat, they didn't want to miss anything in the chat and they didn't want to miss anything in the video and they couldn't divide their attention between the two. So they felt one person, the best email I got the whole week was somebody wrote, said, I thought that the chat was a little bit distracting. He says, it was like I was back in college in a lecture with one of my buddies sitting next to me, except without the hangover. So people did find it a little bit distracting. Other people just absolutely loved it. So I think that what we're going to do is we're going to look for ways of communicating at the start of the webinar that we will capture the chat if people want to and allow people to basically turn off the chat in their feed, just watch the video, and then go back and read the chat later. A lot of people said that they followed the chat and they're going to watch the pre-recorded video later. But they felt that they were spending a lot of time at that point doing that. So there's really no perfect, you know, none of this technology, none of these delivery systems is ever going to be perfect for all people, is it? We just kind of make it as good as we can, develop our own style. And if people come in with expectations of knowing what they're going to get, I think that they'll give us a pass. And for the most part, we've had about 200 responses to the survey that we sent out. They're overwhelmingly responsible, even though we did have some technical challenges. And early on, we did have the technical challenges with the iPad, especially. So what I did, because I was doing a live introduction, is as the webinar went on, each time I introduced it, I was dealing with more of the technical issues up front. So I was telling people right away, as soon as the webinar started, as soon as it fired up, and as soon as we went live, I would tell them right away, anybody on an iPad, please find a notebook, find a desktop computer, move over to that, start it playing, and join the webinar on that platform, because you won't have any joy on the iPad. And most of the people got that message. So by the end of it, the very first few times we delivered, I was doing a lot of technical support at the beginning, as Brooks, the division of labor that I was talking about, had Brooks dealing with talking about all of the Evernote and the paperless office stuff, while I dealt with all of the technical issues. That was a fair division of labor, and people knew who to ask. Steve, I'm having issues. They weren't bothering Brooks, and he was able to concentrate on the mission, which was providing great content, and I dealt with the technical side. So the first one was just a blur in my mind, because I was sending people links to view the replay early and trying to troubleshoot with them, and it was a bit of a nightmare from that perspective. But by the time we did the last few webinars, other than one other little technical glitch, which was operator error on my side, they went tremendously smoothly. We had very few people complaining that they weren't getting the video stream. Everybody was well prepared, and they were going through. The other idiosyncrasy of using a tool like Webinar Jam on top of a Google Hangout is the video stream. Now, our video was an hour and 8 minutes of video, and here's the video right here. This is the landing page. So this is the video. This is the playback page, which everybody can go to. I'll have a link here, and if you visit our page, you can visit and watch the webinar, and you don't have to sign up. You don't have to sign up for newsletters or anything like that. We're not capturing information up front. If you want Brooks bonus content, or if you want, you can sign up for the newsletters here, but this is free and open for people to watch, so you can get a sense of what I'm talking about through this particular, through this page. But where was I? Oh, the video is an hour and 8 minutes long. If you were booted off of the webinar for any reason, if your internet connection ceased, if your computer crashed, if you had a hiccup and you had to restart, you can't join the video stream midstream using this technology, which I find to be a real pain in the parallel port, if you know what I mean, because so many people we didn't have so many. The odd person who was 30 or 35 minutes into the video got booted off. Now they have to start at the beginning. And it's really frustrating for them, and I feel their pain. And they're, of course, not shy about sharing that pain often, but there's nothing that I can do at that point. So that is still an issue that I'm going to be constantly looking for better ways to do. So for now, with all of the warts on it, I would give Webinar Jam a solid 6 out of 10 as far as delivering this webinar. It's not perfect software, and a lot of the problems that we had with it are more related to Google Plus Hangouts than to Webinar Jam, but overall, I felt that these webinars were about a 6 out of 10 on the scale of where I would like to be delivering the content. The content was solid 8. You know, it was right up there. Brooks did a great job on the content. People loved it. You had the odd person that says they wanted a little more advanced, the odd person that says they wanted a little more beginner, but for the most part, we were really happy with the content. I was thrilled with the number of people that signed up, and I'm especially thrilled with the number of people who are engaging with us and giving us some really constructive feedback on it. As I say, what is it now? It's probably over 200 people. Here's the, where is it? Right there, Paperless Office. Let's take a look. How many people we've had 198 responses. Oh, good. And the one that I opened was good. I feel safe opening this because we didn't capture any personal information. Good. It was met. It was very engaging. It's likely they're going to come back, and these are the ones. So yes, people did like it. And so that makes me quite happy. Overall, if we're thinking about growing our YouTube channel, live events like this are a lot of work, but holy cow, they really create an extra level of energy. Now, I'm not sure if the entire community feels that energy. I believe that the people on the webinar feel that engagement and feel that extra level of connection with you, the content creator, because they're dealing with you in real time, and there's just something extra special about that. They're part of a one-time event. When things go a little bit wrong, if something funny happens, they got to participate in that particular moment. So there's just a certain joy and a certain humanity about live and real-time events, even if they're hybrid, such as the one that we did, because we're still there in chat and people know that we're there, and then returning to the end and having the conversation at the end allowed people to stay engaged. The other impressive thing about doing this sort of a webinar is I was watching the attendance. Now, this, I can't tell if you walked away from the computer and just left the tab open and left it playing, but the attendance, the drop-off, was less than 15%. people just stayed with the webinar the whole time. If they were connected and they were in there, even if they weren't chatting with us, they didn't leave the webinar room. They didn't shut down their browser. They didn't disconnect. So I was thrilled to see that level of engagement. So overall, if you're thinking about growing your channel, considering doing live events is a great way to move. You have to recognize that you're probably not going to come across incredibly polished at the first few times that you try it. You know, even though I've got 20 years experience doing live television, live radio, I was still on edge as we went into it. And I know that I could do a better job hosting as we move ahead. And I've got some serious chops in that space. I knew some serious experience in that space. So if you've got no experience in doing that, the juggling of the content and then the juggling of the technology can be a little bit overwhelming. But it's worth taking the journey. It's worth trying. Start small with a small group of people, but look for the right type of content to deliver live. But it does, overall, I think I feel that we've added significant value to our channel, and we've certainly won over some new people who weren't part of it before. The one call to action we did is we did capture email addresses, and so my newsletter list, my email list, grew by several hundred over the course of having the couple of days delivering the webinar. So there's some really good engagement. And there's some good downstream business benefits as a result as well. Well, this was a little bit of a journey, kind of through the experience that we had with delivering the Paperless Office webinar. I hope that you found this little video today to be useful in our journey towards 100,000 subscribers. There's three ways that you can engage here on the Dotto Tech channel. Should you choose to engage in the Dotto Tech channel, we'd love you to subscribe to our channel. After all, we're trying to get to 100,000 subscribers. Sign up for our newsletter. Then you will know about all of these webinars as they come downstream, and you can participate live as well. I'll be doing more than one a month as we move ahead. This is going to be a big part of my business plan moving ahead, is doing these sorts of live webinars, and I'm looking for great guests. I've got some terrific guests lined up over the next couple of weeks coming, and you'll see, if you sign up for the newsletter, you will see who we're doing and what we're going to be doing. Something on LinkedIn, we're going to be doing something on YouTube, search engine optimization. We've got some really interesting and compelling topics coming up. Not all of them for huge audiences, some of them for narrow audiences and a narrow focus, but it's still going to be great events. And finally, Dotto Tech is brought to you, by my Patreon supporters. If you haven't yet taken a look at what is happening on Patreon, it's kind of like Kickstarter, but for content creators like me. It means that I have more time to spend creating content, and I have to spend less time chasing money. I could bring corporate sponsors into the channel, but instead, I'm inviting asking my audience to support us financially. For as little as a dollar a month, you can become a Dotto Tech Patreon patron, and oh my gosh, I appreciate each and every one of you ever so much. And there's perks attached. There are perks. So check out the Patreon page and see the perks. With that, a little bit of a long 100K subscriber video today, but I think overall pretty darn interesting. I'm Steve Dotto. Have fun storming a castle.